He is not here. He is risen. Thus saith the angel of the Lord to the women on that first Easter Sunday morning when Jesus Christ broke the bars of death and rose from the dead. Hear now the servant of the Lord, another angel of the covenant who brings this message. Because Jesus is risen from the dead, he is now here in his spirit and in his word. For the Lord who has made the heavens and the earth has redeemed us to the utmost by his crucified and risen Son, who reigns now at the right hand of God. Receive now God's benediction. Grace, mercy, and peace be granted unto you from God the Father, through Jesus Christ the risen Lord, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue our worship on this day, this wonderful day the Lord has made, 362, come ye faithful, raise the strain of triumphant gladness. God has brought his people forth into joy from sadness. Now rejoice, Jerusalem, and with true affection welcome in unwearied strains Jesus' resurrection. Three stanzas, 362. As we read from the law of God this morning, the Ten Commandments, let's be reminded that we're saved from the condemnation of the law, the guilt of our sin, and we have transgressed all the commandments, but Jesus is our Savior, testified this is by his resurrection from the dead. God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let's now read also in light of this what the Lord God says, I brought my Son from death and into the life of the glory that he had before the earth was created. This is the context of our now receiving the law. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, and I've delivered my Son to death and brought him from death for your sake, Israel. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that's in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing mercy to thousands, to those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you nor your son nor your daughter, nor your male servant nor your female servant, nor your cattle nor your stranger who's within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your neighbor's. Again, we hear this in the light of the New Testament. And in the New Testament, Jesus himself says to his covenanted people, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And he's speaking to a people, and a people that shall enter into his fellowship of the new covenant. And we who have, think of this, not only are we supposed to receive now the commandments of God if we surely love Jesus, as he says, but we are to receive them as the risen people who in this earth we live, but we're not of the earth. Jesus is risen, and now it's our great privilege to live above the fray of the earth in triumph, even though we're in it, and life is hard and there's many, many battles. Yet we live as the holy, resurrected people of God and bound for the resurrection at the final day. What a great, great joy we have to receive God's word, his gospel and his law, and the central message, Jesus Christ crucified and risen. Now we continue in our worship. Number 22 in the Psalter hymnal is a versification of a psalm, and it's Psalm 16, I believe. Yes, Psalter number 22, one of those psalms that stands out as fulfilled in the resurrection. If you look at verse 4, I know that I shall not be left forgotten in the grave, that from corruption thou, O Lord, thy Holy One, wilt save. This was fulfilled on that resurrection morn, and so we sing it now, the five stanzas, 22.
Oh,
Before we go to prayer together, this beautiful day, this day the Lord has made, in which we celebrate in a special way the resurrection of the Savior, do want to remind us and ourselves of earthly things, causes for concern, but also for joy. First of all, we celebrate with the Geissens, with Henry and Annette, the birth of the first grandson, Theodore J., to Katie and Ryan, this morning. And so we congratulate you and Uncle John. There he is, over there. So we don't seek to embarrass you, but to encourage you. What great gifts that the Lord has given in little ones, covenant children as well. We're concerned as well for Mary Runner. She's still in recovery and rehab, unable to go to church, and Evan with her. And the Millers, too, as they're recovering from various ailments and the infirmities of old age. We have many needs and also many reasons to celebrate God's goodness to us as a congregation, and our families and friends. We welcome visitors today and friends as well. And God bless you this day. And may we be revitalized in our faith that looks up, from whence our redemption comes nigh, and it's because Jesus is risen, and so we have great hope. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, thanks for this day that you've made, and set aside now, sealing it with an empty tomb, in the resurrection from the dead of your Son, who could not be held in the grave for longer than you had ordained. And so as he said, after 3 days he would rise, he did. And you took him, and you have received him home. And you have received all of his work of redemption. And so we are sure that the sinners for whom he died, we all, are now saved with him, and participants by faith of the glorious resurrection of the Lamb. We pray, Father, that you would receive our worship and our joy and gratitude in our worship as the thank offerings we would bring for such a great salvation, such a wonderful Savior, Jesus. Thanks, Lord, that you have so ordained these things from eternity and fulfilled them in this our day, in these latter days, so that even though as evil is abounding, nevertheless, there is great hope, the hope that is the hope of all hopes, even the hope of the final resurrection of the body and the reuniting of the souls and the bodies and the beginning of eternity in heaven. Lord, we pray, preach the word to us today. Preach the word to sinners lost that they might be found and saved, discovered and graced by your word. Preach the word, O God, to sinners saved that they might be built up, to sinners wandering that they might be brought back, to sinners who are delighting in Jesus that they might be encouraged, and that all of us, Lord, may be brought together in the unity, the bond of faith, the bond of love, the bond of resurrection power. God bless us, we pray. May the churches across the land be declaring the truth as it is in Jesus, the truth that angels declared to women and which men and women discovered on those first days and which the church has ever lived out of. The truth that Jesus Christ is the Lamb slain for sinners and the Lord risen to the right hand of God. Lord, in the preaching, may there be a word that goes forth that is against the world, that lies in wickedness, and that calls the world to repent and to flee to Jesus, the only hope. May we preach as well, Father, the word of grace to sinners who have been in birth and many for a long time in the society of sinners who of all things would hold Jesus down. And keep the church from preaching and the people of God from living out the truth of the resurrection. Lord, give us that word anew, not only to the preacher and to the elders who oversee the word, but to every congregant, everyone who calls upon the name of Jesus, Lord, give the gift of the Word of God, the truth. Give it, Lord, so that the truth that sets us free from our own worldliness, sets us free from despair, from sin and its habits, from materialism and all such things that bespeak a people that is so prone to deny Jesus Christ crucified and risen. Give, Father, power in our lives to overcome evil and to advance apace every single day in the faith of our fathers living still. Lord, we pray, gather, defend, and preserve your church as Jesus does by his Spirit and word from heaven. And use us, Lord, in the gathering. Raise up men to be preachers of the gospel, men who are in short supply, good men, virtuous men, who have been taught and sat at Jesus' feet and who have been nurtured by the church and by godly parents. We pray for this, Lord, that all of us may know our office as prophet and priest and king. May the children and the young people of the congregation, may the sinners all who fly to Jesus for forgiveness, be those people who are focused on defending the crown rights of the great King of Kings and Lord of Lords. May we be aiming, Lord, aiming toward heaven in everything we do, disciplined as your disciples, set free as those who know the truth that sets free, bound for glory as those who are risen there already. For indeed, as the apostle says, and we will heed, if we be risen with him, may we seek the things above. And God, we pray for those who are sorrowing, for those who have need at this time, that you would care for them. For those whose bodies are breaking down, whose bodies are indicating to them even that it may not be long before they end their earthly pilgrimage, God bless them. And bless those with prognoses of cancer or this or that. Bless the young, the elderly, and all of us in between, that we may know our mortality and the everlasting life that is through faith. Bless those, Lord, who rejoice. We rejoice with the Geisens and with the family that brings forth the child this day, but also with all your people, bringing forth children in this congregation, bearing them with glad expectation that you will be with them and care for them and their children. We rejoice, Father, in the prospect that you are continuing to cause us to grow in the knowledge and grace of Jesus Christ. Not our way, but yours. For you're the God who is the God of the tree that grows from the great vine, the branches that grow. And you are the one who gives the increase in your good way through your prunings so often and your meticulous gardening in the garden of your delight, the Church of Jesus Christ. And here we behold this in our own church. You are our God, and you have planted us in fertile soil, the soil of your word. And you attach us to Jesus, and you give us a ministry that is focused on him, has nothing else to say and is not embarrassed a bit about this. We just preach Jesus Christ crucified and risen. And that's, Lord, our calling, and that's our delight, and that's our prayer. Make it our prayer and delight as we celebrate things eternal with our families and with our friends. And for those, Lord, who are lonely, we pray that they may draw near to you and find on this day and every day a consolation of the great friend we have in Jesus, who is our God and Savior and friend. Hear our prayer, Lord. Forgive the sins of our prayer and of also our constant prayerlessness against which we must wrestle every day. Give us the vitality, the presence of your Spirit, who teaches us Jesus is risen and coming again. For Jesus' sake we do pray. Amen. Your offering now, thank offering, is for the general collection of the church. May God bless us as we give to his cause. Let's turn now in our Psalter hymnal to 357, familiar hymn, "Lo, in the grave he lay, Jesus, my Savior." Now remember, children, we want you to sing these songs too. We want you to sing with us because we know you can sing, and God loves this when the little children of the congregation do sing. So join us all together, 357, three stanzas. Going to have three sermons today. Dinner will have to wait. We will feast now on the Word of God. Three different sermons. For that, I want to read at three or at least two different times with you. And first, we want to read on the things that occurred after Jesus died and with regard to his burial, especially the plotting of the people, the Jewish leaders, and with the Romans to seal the grave. And for that, we turn to Matthew 27, and we want to, let's just begin reading at verse 55 to the end of chapters 27. Later on, we'll read from a narrative that records the resurrection of Jesus, but here, his death and the things that occurred after this, as we shall see presently, is our first sermon. Matthew 27, 55. "And many women who followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering to him," that is, to Jesus, they were serving him, wanting to anoint his body later, "they were there looking on from afar. among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's sons. Now when evening had come, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be given to him. When Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out of the rock. And he rolled a large stone against the door of the tomb and departed. And Mary Magdalene was there, and the other Mary sitting opposite the tomb. On the next day, which followed the day of preparation, that would be on Saturday, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people, 'He is risen from the dead.' So the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard. Go your way. Make it as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. Thus far we'll read from the Word of God, Matthew 27, God's Word, about the death and then the burial and the plotting with regard to the burial and the grave of Jesus. So three sermons today, and I want by this to encourage you that we're going to receive the whole counsel of God with regard to the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so we need three sermons for that. One will have to do with that Saturday when the wicked Jews with the Romans in cahoots with them were seeking to seal the tomb of Jesus to avoid even the appearance that he had risen from the grave. That's the Saturday sermon that'll be based at least broadly on the text that we just read, Matthew 27. Then we'll need, of course, a Sunday sermon, and that will be as we behold and as we're gathered here to behold the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, which could not be denied. And then we want to have a forever sermon. So a Saturday sermon and a Sunday sermon and a forever sermon. And I want to remind you that these sermons, I'm not pulling out of my sleeve. I'm not doing this in order to fill the time. No, never do that. But these sermons I would liken to rivers. And the rivers that I'm tapping into, as it were, as your preacher, and I want you to drink from them, the rivers that flow from the fount of the blood of Jesus that was shed that Good Friday. Rivers of words that come to my mind not only, but that are the mind of God, that he wants the sermon, the people of God to hear, having heard the sermon of the cross. So we want to tap into and drink from and even, as it were, swim in the rivers of the waters of life that come from the cross and the resurrection and the blood of Jesus Christ. 3 points, very simple. Then and now and forever, around the theme, "Vainly they seal the dead." That's taken from a hymn. But that's what's going on here on this Saturday and on the Sunday. "Vainly they seal the dead." We read of the vanity of men and of women, the evil of the world, in this whole narrative of people seeking to seal the tomb of Jesus and to prevent the message of his being risen from ever being heard or promulgated. We read here of the Jews who are afraid, and of the Romans who agree to them. They want to set a seal and guard the tomb, lest the disciples steal the body or some other such thing and perpetuate what they believe is a lie. And the Romans, they agree with the Jews. They don't want any trouble. They don't want any more trouble than they've just had of late. And so they're agreeing to this. And so you see here, the Jews, the priests, the chief priests and the Pharisees in verse 62, they're gathering together with Pilate. What strange bedfellows sin makes. The Jews and the Romans were ever at odds. Their philosophy was different, their religion was different, in a way their God was different. But they were united on this, as they had been at Good Friday. Jesus must die, and Jesus, the myth of Jesus, must not go on any further. He must silence the crowd of disciples, the whole world that seems to have gone after him, and we must keep him in the tomb, and his body there, and his rotting bones there for all to see. And so they say to Pilate, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive," verse 63, "how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise.'" And see what they're doing here with Jesus. He's not the truth, the way, the truth, and the life. He's the wrong way, and he's the liar, and he's dead. That's what the Jews are making of Jesus, that deceiver. "He said, while he was still alive, 'After 3 days I will rise.'" And so there's their principle of their religion. Jesus is dead. We're still looking for a Messiah. And commandments come out of all religions, and so this one. We command, or we urge that you command. He's not going to be so bold, are the Jews, to command Pilate to do anything, but they beg him to command that the tomb of Jesus be made secure. Now, let's just look at this for a minute here. The tomb had already been secured by a great stone that had been rolled over it by Joseph, and Nicodemus as well was with him or involved in the burial of Jesus. A great stone rolled over against the door of this carved-out cave, children. We're not exactly sure where the tomb of Jesus was, what it looked like, but we do know it had been sealed, maybe against wild animals or anybody else who would tamper with the grave. That great stone was large enough so that when the women were coming to the grave that morning, that Sunday morning, they wondered how they could roll it away. And it might have been about 5 feet in diameter, this stone, and lodged in a sort of place where they could roll it from one side to the other, maybe even up to 5, 6, 9 inches thick, this stone. So very, very heavy, certainly something that couldn't be moved. But now the Jews even want it more secure. Again, they're afraid. They want it secure even from a legal point of view. They want the laws of the Romans to be backing us here in our attempt to hold down the body of Jesus. "Let it be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say to the people he's risen from the dead." So the last deception, that he's risen from the dead, will be worse than the first, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, that he is the Messiah. So the Jews here, out for blood? No, they've already gained that end. They've killed Jesus. But they're out to snuff the message that he might be risen, or if possible, the fact that he would rise, if this was all at all possible, by this securing of the stone. And Pilate said, "Okay, you have a guard, go your way, make it as secure as you know how." And that would have been with a seal of Rome on it, a seal of the tomb. Would have been an impression made with wax over the edge of the stone, with Caesar's inscription and so on, and the idea of sealing things like letters or stones of the Roman Empire over tombs, which they wanted sealed, was to make it so that people wouldn't dare tamper with what was sealed. For if one dared to tamper with what was sealed, off with the head. It was that bad. And so they had this guard, as well as a Roman guard who would be standing around the tomb and so on, and maybe at least for 3 days, as Jesus had said, after 3 days I will rise. And they went and they made the tomb secure, and they sealed the stone and they set the guard. And interesting, Pilate says, go your way, make it as secure as you know how. I don't know what all that means, but the implications of that is, as we'll see, astounding. This is just what people do today. They want to keep Jesus down as much as they know how, with all that is within them. Now, this is the attempt of the wicked here. The very first attempt to keep Jesus in the grave, or to keep the disciples from perpetuating a lie that Jesus had risen from the grave by stealing his body. Must be that something was recognized by those wicked Jews about the import of his resurrection. Must be that they were recognizing something that very few even recognize today, of the significance of Jesus' resurrection. And indeed, Jesus' resurrection is very, very significant and important. We recognize that too. In fact, the church has ever known that everything of the gospel hinges on the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Everything. We are a resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, believing church and preaching church, or nothing. We might as well go home. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the message of the Church of Jesus Christ. It's the hope of all our hopes. It's the power of our living for Jesus. It's our joy and consolation now and forevermore. For I want you to think about these things here. Seven or so of them, the things which hinge on the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So that if Jesus isn't raised, these things cannot be confirmed. In fact, they're lies. The first thing is this, what I call, big word here, children, the authenticity of Jesus. The fact that he is the Son of God, the fact that he is the Savior, that all hinges on whether he rises from the dead or not. Everything Jesus said about himself as the way and the truth and the life, the forgiver of sins, the one who's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, this all depends upon whether he can conquer death, which is the wages of sin. Was Jesus a hoax? Was he a liar and a deceiver, as the Pharisees would say? Or was he real? Is your Jesus a hoax? Was he a lunatic or a liar? Or is he Lord? That's the question. And again, if he be not risen from the dead, his authenticity is not only to be questioned, but it's to be denied. He cannot be the Savior. He cannot save his people from his sins if he himself cannot conquer death, not only for himself, but for his people. The second thing on which the resurrection hinges is the very Word of God. The very Word of God, Old Testament and New Testament. Isaiah 53 had said that the suffering Savior of the Lord, the Lamb of God, would bear the sin of many and pray for the transgressors, and his soul would be satisfied. He would see the end of the travail of his body and of his soul. He would conquer. That's the word of Isaiah. And if Jesus be not risen from the dead, that prophecy falls to the ground. The very word of God returns void to God. God's word is not true. And so there's the other Psalm 16 that's often cited even in the New Testament. It says, and we sang a versification of that, Psalm 16, my soul shall not be forgotten in the grave, and you will not forget your Holy One to see corruption. That's all fulfilled in Jesus, who is not forgotten in the grave, and He, the Holy One, did not see corruption. See, that was a difference between his death and ours. He did not decay or begin to decay, because when he died, this is not only a state of his humiliation, but I believe the beginning of his exaltation. There's an honor in this grave, in this resting place, as the Son of God lies there incarnate in his body. Well, again, if Jesus is not risen, then these words of the Old Testament, they fall to the ground. And dare we say this, if Jesus is not risen, he himself has been mistaken in his foolhardy notion that he would rise. For the Pharisees were right at this. He did say, after 3 days I will rise. And that's indeed testified in the rest of the Gospels. Mark 8, for example, Mark 10, Jesus was saying repeatedly, I'm going to suffer, but after 3 days, I will rise. If Jesus did not rise, then he himself is a liar, mistaken, or foolishly deluded at best. Well, so the authenticity of Jesus, the Word of God, and Jesus' own Word, they all hinge on the resurrection. Well, I want to say this as well. Everything about Jesus, the Savior, hinges on Jesus, the risen Savior. Jesus' humiliation, his cross, death, as a satisfaction for sin and a conquering of death, it hinges on his rising from the dead, his being the perfect offering to God so that he himself did not have to pay for himself, but he paid for others as a substitute. That is what must be attended by his conquering. And God not leaving him in hell, but accepting his offering. And so his humiliation is so round up with the resurrection. But then the great truth of his exaltation depends upon his rising from the dead. Because if he's in the dead, he's just low. He's just down. He's just dying, dead, and decaying. He cannot be this exalted one to the right hand of God. So the first and the last of all the truth that Jesus ever taught, they depend on his rising from the dead. And then I quickly go through the last points of what is at stake here in the resurrection. And number four is the application of salvation to the church. For you see, Peter says, we are begotten again to a lively hope, 1 Peter 1, by the resurrection from the dead. So there's this resurrection of Jesus, but the gospel is there's this resurrection of Jesus that makes us to rise from the dead, to be born again. And we cannot be born again, says Peter, because he links Jesus' resurrection and ours, unless Jesus is risen. We are begotten again to a lively hope through the means of the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And so this is the significance of Easter Sunday morning, indeed. Then I would say too, the very existence and the power and the mission of the Church of Jesus Christ all depends upon whether Jesus Christ is risen or not. We preach Jesus Christ crucified, and it means nothing if we preach not Jesus Christ risen. And we cannot preach Jesus Christ risen if Jesus is not risen. We might as well go home. Well, then doesn't it all depend, or doesn't the truth of heaven and the final resurrection all depend upon the resurrection? Yes, indeed. And then one other thing, grace itself is wrapped up in the resurrection. But don't we see here at Sovereign Grace, we preach Christ crucified and risen, and we have then the message that there's a God who comes down for our sake. There's a God who goes down, down, down into the dark and the pit of hell, but who's risen for our sake as well. And so that he's not just gone down, and we have to rise up now ourselves and meet the cross halfway. He's down and he's risen, God all the way and all the time, our God. That's called grace. That's called free salvation. And the resurrection attests to that. Now, I don't know exactly if those evil men, I'm sure they weren't, if they were thinking of all of these things, but they knew something. The resurrection from the dead of Jesus Christ, who said he would rise, is very important to those Christians, as it was to Jesus, and so we have to deny this thing, or the appearance of this thing. No, cannot happen. Cannot happen. Well, did it happen? Second sermon, Sunday. You can open your Bibles with me now to Matthew 28 if you would like. Certainly, the story is familiar. I want to repeat for you what we hear so often, so wonderfully, every year, and we're reminded of this all the time. Matthew 28. And they seal the stone and set the guard and keep Jesus down? That's the question. Can they prevent not only his physical resurrection, but can they prevent the message? That's the question. Hear the Sunday sermon. Now after the Sabbath, Saturday, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. What will they see, children? What will they see? And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. The angel didn't care about seals or the weight of the stone. His countenance was like lightning and his clothing as white as snow, and the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. But the angel answered and said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. Hear the message of the angel, beloved. He's not here, for he is risen as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and indeed he's going before you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." So they went out quickly from the tomb, those women, with fear and great joy, and ran to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus, the risen Jesus, met them saying, "Rejoice." So they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee. There they will see me." There it is. Hallelujah! Jesus is risen. Jesus, the crucified, is risen. Death cannot hold him, nor soldiers, nor seals, nor stones. He's risen from the dead. We don't know how it happened. Nobody saw it. Such a mysterious passing from death into life and passing through clothes into glory. The glorious existence of the resurrection. That's Jesus' resurrection. That's reason for great fear, but also reason for great joy. For God has done something here. And Easter Sunday, as we call it, Resurrection Sunday, is all about God doing something. God not suffering his Holy One to see corruption. God confirming the truth of the crucifixion of the Savior, saying, "Well done, saying hell is enough, it's paid by the one for the many, for you and for me. He's risen. And those Pharisees, those Jews, ants and flies, that's all they are. Daring in their commotion, in their stirred ants' nest, in the carcass of their civilization, flying around, starting to, or trying to maintain desperately some sort of order. They can't keep him down. You see, it's because Jesus is not just a good man. And the story of the resurrection is not just you can't keep a good man down. It's about God. It's about God's anointed one. It's about God in the flesh. It's about God in the flesh rising. It's about the great mystery of godliness. It's about the wonderful, glorious God. And now the Son is returning in answer to his prayer to the glory he had before the worlds were made as the eternal Son of God, who's been incarnate, who will ever be incarnate, but who will now enter back into this wonderful normalcy for him, the glory of his pre-incarnate existence with God, as God, always God, in the communion of the Holy Spirit, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Can't keep him down. Can't keep the good God's word from being fulfilled. The resurrection is the seal that God is God. Now, what does it look like in our day, in our church, in this world, in our families, in our society? You think that this event here, and I want you to know, this is just in a little corner of the world. It's a long way from here. Long way from here. And nobody knows anymore where the empty tomb is. People like to think they're finding a tomb of bones now and again of Jesus. They'd like to keep him down that way, but nobody knows where his tomb is. I wonder if anybody even cares where Jesus is now. You see, there's a great attempt. I'm back to Saturday, because in many ways it's Saturday even now, and nobody lives out of Sunday anymore, out of the truth of the resurrection. But you see, there's a great attempt still, even as there was after that resurrection Sunday in the first century. There's a great attempt still of the devil to get the resurrection out of the picture of history. That's true. It's true. The devil, you see, he doesn't like this light. He can't stand it. It hurts his eyes. The devil's eyes. So if somehow he could turn back the clock, so it's not the other side of the resurrection. Let's go back to Saturday, where the Jews and the Pharisees were plotting. If he could do that, well, that would be good. But then you see, he'd still have to go back to Friday and do something about that. And so the devil, you see, he's trying to roll back time, trying not to roll back the stone except over the grave and to cover up Jesus and so on. But he's trying to, as he always does, make a liar out of Jesus. And make a liar out of his church. And out of his preachers. And out of his confessors. He wants to go back before I know from the Word of God, this is the nature of the devil. He wants to go back even to where there was no Word of God yet spoken into this fallen world. That would be just about Genesis 3, wouldn't it? When Adam and Eve fell, And before God came to them in the garden and preached Christ to them, the devil is wanting to interfere. The devil who had tempted Adam and Eve and who had caused this whole world to grow into darkness and had resulted by his machinations in the crucifixion of the Savior. He wants to go back in time and back to where he and his word were king. And therefore, he wants to get this whole world rid of the notion of the gospel of Easter. How does he do that? Well, he's made all of us materialists, hasn't he? Materialism is you just live for what you see and you eat and you drink and you marry and tomorrow you die and there's no such thing as an afterlife. The world is taken by materialism. Now, I know many people are religious. We'll see something of that tonight. But their religion is in the wrong God. And when it comes down to it, all people have nowadays is the stuff that they eat, the hotels that they build, the campaigns that they win, the causes that are theirs. Nothing for the soul. Because you see, what the devil has done a good job at, if we can say that he does anything well, is to perpetuate the lie that Jesus is, after all, just a myth or just a man, not a Messiah. And therefore, he's the good man who laid down his life for a cause. And you can't keep the good man down in the minds of those who like the message of the man, of peace and goodwill. And we can be like him and make the world a better place. That's how the lie of the devil was working nowadays. Jesus is a good man and his message is of a good man who died for a cause. And you can't keep the good man down in the minds of the people who follow him. In the minds of the people who are drugged on this message of the Messiah and of a better place called heaven. But all of this is the denial of the real Jesus and of the cross of Jesus and of the need for bodily resurrection. Sadly, this lie of the devil has infiltrated the church called the Church of Christ. And so you have a denial among the liberals of the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. And again, people of God, I'm not here just to be negative, but truth has to be set forth over against the lie. We'll find ourselves sliding into the lie ourselves. And it's a battle. And it's a battle not only on the liberal front, but even among the conservatives who take the cross out of the message and who just preach something like Jesus is risen and now you can have a great life in something, but the focus is just on maybe part of this whole history here. Maybe it's just Sunday, but there's a woeful neglect of Friday and of the preaching of sin and grace and of the need for Messiah to rise for our justification, because otherwise we would hardly be right with God. We would not be right with God at all. And so, in one way or another, we're affected. We all are. You have to admit it. How does our faith in Jesus' resurrection show itself? Really? How consistent is our Christianity in as our faith with that of the early church that gave up everything for following Messiah and believing him and preaching him to the end of the world? How is it? How is it that we're not affected by the crass materialism And the idolatry of the age that fills itself on things because it thinks things are the only things that can satisfy. Are we like that? Here's the test. We know very little of repentance, very little of forgiveness. It shows in our pride, our holding grudges, and in our not rising above our own sinfulness and so on. Isn't it? Here's a test. Ask yourself this. How's your prayer life? How's my prayer life? Jesus died and is risen again to make prayers out of a people. To make people who plead with God for mercy and who rejoice in God in the private of their own heart and of their own closet, who are in this world, but they're not of it. That's what Jesus has made. That's why Jesus is risen. How are we doing? Isn't the battle hard? And the devil would win, especially the young people. He thinks us old timers and so on, oh, we're not even worth getting. Maybe he's had us in a habitual, traditional sort of Christianity, and there's no potential in us anymore. We're so hamstrung in our lives, aren't we? But all those young people, they seem to be glowing. They seem to be singing the songs of Messiah, and up from the grave he arose. I just heard it. With joy and delight, if the devil could only snuff out the joy and the delight. If he could only bend your direction to another direction, and the cross, and then to the empty tomb, and then to heaven, oh, he'd have you. The assault on the next generation of the church is mighty. But what's happened? Has the devil won? I'm going to defy the devil today and declare Jesus is risen and Jesus is the conqueror over the church. I'm going to declare the victory and ask and plead with the congregation to declare the victory with me. Because the devil never wins, and God always wins, and the truth of the resurrection and of our living out of it starts here. And where a church preaches the truth as it is in Jesus, as they did at first, and so we now. 1 Corinthians 15. Here's the proof that the devil doesn't win, because we still preach like this. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by men came death, by men also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Christ all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. Each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterwards those who are Christ's at his coming. Here's proof. Here's the proof. Jesus is risen. The church still, the true church still says it like it is. We preach Friday, we preach Saturday, we preach Sunday, we preach forever. Jesus Christ is risen. Until the kingdom come, that will be our message. Until your servant dies and another takes his place, that will be our delight at Sovereign Grace Church. Won't it? I know it will. And here's why. Because God has gotten the victory among us too. Not just in a preacher and among a consistory, but in the congregation. Here's confessors here, and I want to encourage you in this, who know and who taste and see Jesus Christ is crucified for me and risen for me. You say that, don't you? I know that. God knows that. And so we have people here who are saying with Paul, to me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. To die is gain. To me to live is Christ, it's everything. And to die is gain. And we believe with Paul that we're joined to Jesus' death and we're joined to his resurrection. And we say with Paul, we're risen with Christ and we begin to seek the things that are above. And this is the confession I know of every one of you who calls on the name of the Lord. As Paul says in Philippians 3, what things were gained to me, these I've counted loss for Christ. Yes, indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in his righteousness, and, as he says, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. That's you. Struggling you, to be sure, but that's the real you that I know and that God knows. The devil wants to convince you when you sin, it can't be you. But God would persuade us of the better things of the resurrection. That's why we're here. We've been persuaded already. And now we're more and increasingly persuaded, aren't you? No room for doubt here in the congregation. No room for doubt, because all you see is mud, and in your life it's soup and swamp and stuff and sin and not the Savior. Because we have the Word, and God has given us faith, you see. And of all things, if we are to go forward, may it be in our knees and may it be living up. As God says, is our portion and our privilege. And our motivation? Well, it's the glory of God, isn't it? Why do we want to preach the risen Savior? Because then God gets the glory. And Christ gets the glory. Why do we want to continue to preach and to hear our have our children preach and be catechized in the church about the things of grace and of the great God of our salvation? Why? So that they may receive a crown of life by and by, and then heaven, as they seek by faith to live out in this fallen world, in this deceiving world, to live out of the truth. Who's the way and who's the life? We preach Jesus, crucified and risen, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, forever Christians. Now you live like that, people of God. And as Jesus said, the very first word he said to the women, I leave with you, because Jesus is risen, this one word from the Savior, rejoice. Amen. God in heaven, we pray that you would bless now the offering of our sermon, the offering of our ears, and the offering of the resolution we now make. Lord, we're going to believe among the unbelievers. We're going to put down our own old nature that fights with us. We're going to live out of the truth that Jesus is risen. We're going to do this, Lord, because you're everything to us. And you've proved how great a God you are to us. You've proved that to us in your word. You've shown it. You've demonstrated how great you are, how loving you are, how kind. You've raised your Son from the pit of hell. And now we rise with him. Amen. Let's turn now to 233. Surely we behold the goodness of God in the resurrection, so we join with the psalmist who calls us in Psalm 118 to exalt Jehovah's goodness. Let's sing stanzas 1, 6, and 8 of 233. After we receive the benediction, let's sing from the Doxology 488, printed in your bulletins. Receive God's benediction. Go in peace and joy in the light of the resurrected Savior. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, of our risen Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Served by the ministry of Reverend Mitchell Dick, worships each Lord's Day at 9:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. at the Chapel of Kuiper College, located at 3333 East Beltline Northeast, between 3 Mile and 4 Mile Roads. You are most cordially welcome to join us for worship or visit us online at www.sgurc.org or contact us by phone at 616-406-8562. It is our prayer that the Lord would add His indispensable blessing to this ministry in order that His name would be glorified through the edification of His people and the translation of sinners out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of